In the last video, we have seen a first example of a phase splitter design. As you can see, this is based on one ECC81 tube, which is composed by two triodes. In this first example, the power supply voltage is 250 volts. The value of each plate resistor is 100,000 ohm. And we have seen how to draw the load line, and this is an example of choice of operating point along the load line. In this case, we have chosen 2 mA idle current as operating point, which corresponds to minus 1.52 volt. This is the polarization voltage, which at the end gives 1.5% distortion. In this new video, we will see some developments from this initial design and other examples of phase splitter design. Let's try with lowering the plate resistor. Every other parameter is exactly the same. So we reduce the plate resistor to 27 kilo ohm. You will remember before it was 100 kilo ohm. 27 kilo ohm seems a more appropriate value. There is a, let's say, rule of thumb which says that the plate resistor should be more or less equal to two times the inherent resistance of the tube. In my case, the ACC81 shows a resistance of about 10 kilo ohm, which of course depends on the loading condition, on the operating point, etc. But more or less it's in the order of magnitude of 10 kilo ohm. So 27 kilo ohm seems a more appropriate value. You see that in this case I can choose an operating point with much higher current, which I prefer, for the reasons I explained before. Higher current means lower output impedance and higher capability to drive the following stage, and according to my ears, better sound. You see that the distortion is lower, is 1.1%, again calculated with the help of the simulator I'm posting here, and again credits to this website for the calculation. As the steepness of the load line has increased, of course my gain is decreased. This is not a problem, because we will see we will have at the end plenty of gain to play with, so this is absolutely not a problem. So here, in order to achieve 44 volt peak to peak, I need an input signal going from minus 0.2 volt to minus 1.5 volt. So while before 1 volt peak to peak was sufficient, now I need 1.3 volt peak to peak. But again, this is absolutely not a problem. When doing the final design, we might choose a slightly lower current operating point, because you see that the maximum voltage, maximum input voltage here is minus 0.2, which really approaches 0 volt, which is maybe not so good. So we will choose a slightly lower current operating point. Let's see what happens if we increase slightly the high voltage applied to the tube. We increase to 275 volt. So in this case, if we keep the percentage the same, 18% voltage on the tail and 82% voltage on the plate resistor, the value of the value to consider for my load lines is 225 volt. Still, we have a plate resistor of 27 kilo ohm. So again, in the same way we plotted before, now we have this kind of load line. Again, I choose 5 to 5.2 milliamps of for the operating point, which corresponds to minus 0.8 volt of polarization applied. The distortion, as you can see, is highly reduced again, 0.85%, which is very good considering this is a phase splitter, which again has some inherent negative feedback, which will further reduce the distortion. In this case, in order to achieve my output swing of 44 volt, I need an input signal from minus 0.2 to minus 1.4. So my input swing should be 1.2 volt peak to peak. This will not be the final setup. Again, also in this case, I might slightly lower the operating point current, because again, it's not good to approach a 0 volt line like that. Let's anyway stick with this setup in order to show you how to calculate all the other, let's say, components and all the other specifications of this setup. First of all, we can calculate the value of the tail resistor. You remember we have a 50 volt on the tail, of course minus 0.8, which is my bias voltage, divided by the polarization current. Here you see 0.010, which is 10 milliamps. I did not write 5 milliamps, but 10 milliamps. This is the first point when we begin to consider that we have two tubes other than one. So, as the tail resistor supports both tubes, so we have both tubes conducting. So we have to multiply by two the idle current, and in this case, that's why. I put 10 milliamps. So if we do, if you calculate, we find 5 kilo ohm for the tail resistor. Also very important, the bias resistor needs to be calculated. So we have 0.8 volt, which is my idle bias voltage, divided by 10 milliamps again, and the result is 80 ohm. One interesting calculation is about the balance or imbalance of the two sections. There is a formula, I will not explain it in detail. Credit to the Valve Wizard website for that. We can understand that the balance depends on the tail resistor, so the higher the tail resistor, the higher the balance between the two sections, and the lower the plate resistor and of course the tube inherent resistance, the higher the balance. So in this case, if we do our math, the plate resistor is 27 kilo ohm, the inherent tube resistance is more or less 10 kilo ohm, this is approximate of course. The tail resistor is 5 kilo ohm, the mu of the tube is 60, this is the mu of the ACC81 tube. So if we do our math, we find 12% unbalance, which is pretty good, which also means that we need to implement a plate resistor on the grounded input tube, so the tube on the right, which is 12% higher than the other plate resistor. Let's now calculate the output impedance. Again, these are all very approximate calculations. Of course, it will be very important to carefully test the amplifier on the field once it will be completed, in order to really, first of all, confirm that it's sounding good, but also in order to fine-tune all the values of the components in order to achieve what we think is the perfect sound. So this is what I'm describing here are just approximate guidelines. But anyway, the output impedance comes from the parallel between the inherent tube resistance, which we remember is 10 kilo ohm, and the plate resistor. In this case, if we do our math, we find 7200 ohm, so 7200 ohm, which is again pretty good. You remember this has to drive more or less 100 kilo ohm input impedance of the following stage. So this is pretty good. Other tubes like ECC83 have a much higher inherent resistance, about 100 kilo ohm in this case. So those tubes, in my opinion, are not so suitable to act as a phase splitter, are not so suitable to properly drive at the output stage of a power amplifier. One of the last parameters to calculate in this condition is the gain. We have already seen that in this situation we need 1.2 volt peak-to-peak input signal in order to get the full swing of 44 volt peak-to-peak. You remember 44 volt is the output swing which can drive the output tubes at full power. So in this case we get a gain of 36 times. At the end, I think we'll implement a phase splitter based on this ECC81. But let's, just as curiosity, let's examine other tubes which are equally appropriate to be utilized on a phase splitter. We have this interesting Russian tube, which is the 6N6P. Let's keep the condition we have seen before unchanged. So we have a 275 volt high voltage. We have a slightly lower plate resistance because this tube has a lower inherent resistance. So again, we plot the load line, which starts at 225 volt. My load is 18 kilo ohm, which comes from the parallel between the plate resistance and the following stage input impedance. Again, we have chosen in this case an operating point of 8.4 milliampere, which corresponds to minus 2 volt applied at the input of the first tube. In order to achieve a swing of 44 volt, here I need an input voltage from minus 0.5 to minus 3.6. So you understand that this tube, that with this tube, I have a lower gain than previous one. What's interesting here, and maybe you could also guess from the spacing of the load lines you see on the right, the distortion is very low, is 0.6%. As you remember, the phase splitter is an inherently negative feedback circuit. So this figure of 0.6 will even further decrease. So again, this will be very good. Again, the current flowing through the tail is 16.8 milliamps. So in this way, I can calculate the value of my tail resistor and the bias resistor. The output impedance is much lower. You remember the figure achieved with the ECC81. These very good specification come at a price which is a higher unbalance. So we have a 34% imbalance. So in order to implement a phase splitter based on this tube, the value of the resistor on the right should be 34% higher than the value of the resistor of the plate resistor on the left. Another tube which is often utilized as a phase splitter is the ECC99. Let's keep all conditions the same as before, so the same high voltage, the same plate resistance, etc. So in this case I chose an operating point at 8.2 milliamps. Again, still a little bit on the higher side, so if I will decide to implement this solution, I will lower a little bit the value of the current in the operating point. The value of the tail resistor is 3 kilo-ohm, the value of the bias resistor is 112 ohm. The output impedance is a little bit higher in this case than what achieved with the previous tube. This time is 2000 ohm. And again, we have a pretty high imbalance of 35%. The gain is a little bit higher, is 20 in this case. So that's all for the moment. I hope you found this video interesting. Thank you for your attention, and see you in the next video.